Thank you, everybody. So how much does everyone know about Arab culture or Muslim culture here in the United States? Unfortunately, when most people think about Arabs or Muslims, they think about the clash of civilization, they think about refugee crisis, terrorism, extremism, all kinds of things. And this is my goal now, to show you some other part of our Arab culture and Muslim culture, so that we don't always have only one impression of everything. I don't blame everybody, because most of the time we're just watching the news, and the news is very narrow. But my whole goal is to give you familiarity. So my goal is that familiarity leads to tolerance. Because when we are unfamiliar, we tend to stereotype. When we don't know about somebody, we just take the view that was already given to us by somebody else, or by some news agency, or by some way of thinking. So this is my chance to make you more familiar. I want you to be exposed to the Arab culture a little bit more, because this will get us past tolerance, maybe even to love. Maybe you'll even enjoy or appreciate this part of the world even more. So, the problem for most Americans is they have very little contact with people from the Islamic community, and therefore, the tendency is to stereotype. The way you can cure that, to the extent you can, is by the reduction of ignorance and by maximizing contact between people. So this was Donald Jackson, the president of a Texas chapter of the American Civil Liberties Union. Now this was 1999. This is not even 9/11 yet, not even before we had all the massive challenges to understanding Arab culture or to being comfortable around Muslims. So the whole idea, like he's saying, is that I would like to have more contact. I would like the two sides to be more familiar with each other, so that we would have less conflict. So, in order to do this, I'm going to make you more familiar. Thank you. This is a riqq. Now, in the United States, we have a tambourine. Perhaps we've played it. All of these advanced techniques, getting excited, joining the band, and all of the above, another instrument to help learn. But this, in the Arab world, it's called not tambourine, but riqq. And the riqq, it's a classical music instrument. We have to play it with our fingers. We have to go to school to learn how to play it. Well, they didn't always look like this. They used to look like this. They used to be made from wood, pearl, brass, and the skin of a fish. Now it is made from wood, brass, and the skin of a plastic. And this means that I can depend on it whenever I want. So the riqq would be a classical music instrument in the Arab world, played like this. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. To be Arab, like American, was and is a civilization and a cultural trait, rather than a racial mark. To be Arab meant to be from the Arabic-speaking world, a world of common traditions, customs, and value, shaped by a single and unifying language. Now, there must be a difference we all understand between Arab and Muslim, Arab and Islam. So Arab is a cultural trait, okay? It is a civilization. It is not a religion. Actually, it could be Arab, I could be Christian, Muslim, Jew, atheist, some other extra thing, but Islam provided the dynamism, but it was the Arab language which provided the bond that held the Arab world together. Now, this means that Islam is what helped us come in contact with the Arab world, and there is always going to be a connection between these two, but we need to understand somebody that is Muslim may or may not be Arab, somebody that is Arab may or may not be Muslim. So this is from the American Arab Anti-Discrimination Committee in Washington, D.C., and that is a organization that helps people understand what Arabs are about and to defend Arabs if we're ever defamed in public and things like this. So it's a very, very important thing that we've learned is that we have to share our culture and have to let people know about us and not just accept the stereotype, because the stereotypes will always not be favorable, but it's not your fault, because what we need to do is have more people sharing with each other. So what I've done is I have gone to over 300 public schools all over the United States to share Arabic culture. But I'll tell you how it happened. First of all, 9/11, I was so scared. And I'll tell you why I was scared. I was scared of two things, because after September 11, with the terrorist attacks that we all know about now, people have talked about it, well, I was scared of two things. First, I was scared of terrorists. Okay, I'm Arab, I'm a Muslim, but I thought that this is extreme and that this is something that I'm in danger of too. When a plane hits a building, everybody in it dies. They're not going to discriminate and say, veer to the left, veer to the right, spare Abdullah in the third window. They're not, it's gonna smash. And then this is what happened. So I am afraid of terrorism like everybody else, but then I was also afraid of reprisal, of people thinking that like I somehow am part of this, or that I condoned it, or that I accepted, or I cheered for it just by mere fact of my association. So I was scared. I stayed at home for a very, very long time, maybe 2 weeks. And then, after a while, a friend of mine who teaches in elementary school told me that there is a young child, fourth grader, third grader possibly, who is getting harassed by their peers because they had an Arabic name and everybody in the school was, calling her names in slander and all the above, and who knows how cruel children can be sometimes. And I thought, okay, I'm a grown adult and I can defend myself. I have loud drums and I'd stand up here and yell and have a big voice. What happens for this small child? So I went to the school on the teacher's request to give them a presentation on Arabic culture, and I ended up going to so many schools after that, over 300 schools with my Arabica program. So this is me playing the riqq for a bunch of very excited little children. Look at how they love it. So this is another impression that they get to have. Not just the buildings falling down, but somebody playing the tambourine or the riqq. And now we have a bigger group doing Arabic line dancing. So this is where we all stomp at the same time. It's a style of dance called debki. And we're in a gymnasium. Some of them get it, some of them don't, but the vibe is there. Going here, forward, back, forward, back. Like this, we all get it, right? Some of them are really into it, almost like it's sports. Them to say ha every time they stomp. So it might be right here. It was like the slow motion version. Just like this, everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you. Catch them early. Basically, the more familiarity they have when they're younger, the less likely it is for them to be overwhelmed by political situations and the news and stuff like that. Just to have a balance, so that one time when they see somebody, you know, who is from Lebanon or Syria or whatever, they know about this dance as well, and not just the things that are in the news. And some of these children are really affected very well. This is my favorite quote of all. I want to be Arab when I grow up. I let it go. I mean, of course I can explain to them, no, it's a language group or whatever, but why not? Let this young fourth grader from Virginia enjoy the possibility of being just like that crazy man that visited, okay? Research shows that the U.S. identified more than 160 Muslim American terrorist suspects and perpetrators in the decade since 9/11. Just a percentage of the thousands of acts of violence that occur in the United States each year. So let me paraphrase, 160 is a lot, and we should be, you know, concerned and afraid, obviously, and I don't mean to belittle it, but it is a small percentage of the total acts of violence, and that's in 10 years, and there are thousands of acts of violence within each year. So there's a perception that it is greater than it actually is. An efficient system of government, prosecution, and media coverage brings Muslim American terrorism suspects to national attention, creating the impression, perhaps unintentionally, that Muslim American terrorism is more prevalent than it really is. Since 9/11, the Muslim American community has helped prevent nearly 2 of every 5 Al-Qaeda terrorist plots. Tips from the Muslim American community are the largest single source of initial information to authorities about these few plots. And so this is a Gallup poll on Islamophobia from 2011. Gallup are the people who take polls to decide, like, are you possibly going to vote for this president, and what do they stand for, and do people appreciate what aspects of each political issue. So what I'm trying to say, and it's a point that I've made so many times, is don't alienate the Muslims in the United States. Because if you have, let's say, a political candidate that says, you know, the police the Muslim neighborhoods more, or if you have a political candidate that says, don't let any Muslims into the United States anymore, well, what you're doing is you're alienating your biggest ally against the war on terror. And this stereotype, we'll keep using the word stereotype, is actually to the disadvantage of defending yourself against terrorism, because Muslims are on the forefront of this fight against terrorism. We have to alienate those wrongdoers within our own community. So if we're alienated, we won't alienate the extremists. So this is a way to think about this more, which is don't alienate the people that help you the most. So let's continue with being more familiar. I'm going to teach you now how Arabs feel. Now we have a style of performing that we call tarab. Now tarab means enchantment from singing. It means that when somebody plays music, they're absorbed with it, they're overwhelmed by it, they have an ecstatic experience. So it's not simply, you know, just like, thank you very much for playing your instrument and for entertaining. No, they get into it. And not just the musicians. You're not going to see a musician getting so excited on stage, you're going to see the audience helping the musician be excited. So tarab is sort of a two-way give and take, where the artist perform something, and the people then respond to that artist by giving exclamations. But first of all, I talked about emotions. Every scale of music has a certain emotion ascribed to it. Say, for instance, I want you to feel happy, uplifted, and positive. I want you to feel serious and heavy. Say, for instance, I want you to feel something mysterious or otherworldly. Say I want to crush your soul and make you feel overwhelmed and sad and maybe even a little bit scared. You to feel enthusiastic, happy that life is awesome with no problems. All right, thank you. Thank you. Just so you know, this instrument is called buzuq. You can see the original one that is in the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics. So if you look at the ancient Egyptian, those paintings that are on, you know, the tombs or whatever, you'll see three women, very uncladly dressed. And in the one in the middle is playing this ancient Egyptian tanbur, which is now called the buzuq. You'll find this instrument in Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, Jordan, Iraq, all the fashionable countries right now, okay? So next time you see the civil war in Syria, remember the buzuq. Now, of course, it's a participatory act, tarab. What happens is I'm going to play something in the music. Perhaps I will make a pause. Perhaps I will change from one scale to the other. Perhaps I'll play something exciting. What you're supposed to do is let me know that you're in it with me, all right? And this is how we do it. We have our four most favorite words to say during this performance. Okay, so repeat after me, everybody. Allah.
Allah.
And that means the God. Next, we have Yassalam.
Yes,
now, this is how we know that you're not a tourist shopping, but you're a real Arab. It's not Asalam, but Salam. Yassalam.
Yes,
literally means, oh, peace. But it kind of feels like, ah, salam. Next one, aywa. Aywa, which means yes. So of course, if you like something, you're going to yell yes to me, aywa. Then the last one, oof. Oof, which means I am very overwhelmed by what has just happened, okay? And then of course, you're an artist too, it's not just me. So you can, I just say, you don't have to just say Allah. You can say Allah.
Allah.
Allah. Allah!
Allah!
Allah. Yes, salam!
Yes, salam!
Yes, salam!
Yes, salam!
Good. Aywa! 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 Aywa!
Aywa!
Very good. Oof!
Oof!
Oof! Oof! You got the idea, and you're so good at this, okay? Now, what we'd like to do is, whenever I'm going to play for you, you have to be here with me, all right? You have to join in this with me. So, say, for instance, I pause. You got the idea. That's a good time to say it. What happens if maybe I change to a different maqam? You got the idea, right? What happens if I get really emphatic? Very nice, you got the idea, all right? So whenever any of these spontaneous moments happen, I want you to give me Allah, ya salam, aywa, auf, or some equivalent, all right? And let's do this together. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. So without all of this participation, I would not have the feeling, I would not get this enchantment. I would just be some guy in Kentucky strumming a strange instrument. But instead, you're part of my presentation. Okay? Now, terror and extremism is not the most original of all the stereotypes. So, used to be that instead of the bomb, we had magic potion. Used to be instead of the mullah or, you know, the evil sheikh, we had the genie. Okay? So we had something called Orientalism. And this is the earliest stereotype of people from my part of the world.
So it's not a new thing.
Sesame, open Sesame Street, Aladdin's lamp granting him three wishes, Princess Jasmine, dark skin and delicious. In the desert, the dance of the seven veils, seven women for every one male. Ancient Baghdad, 1001 nights, centuries later, home to all the airstrikes. Snake charmer, under a desert moon, Sindbad the sailor singing an exotic tune. Cross the Sahara in a caravan, slower than a minivan, but that would sink in quicksand. Casbah the Zod, home to Hocus Pocus, by frankincense, hookah, lotus, or hummus. Omar the magician and Abdullah the genie use their sorcery to weaponize. Names are longer than the Silk Road, and the camel teams can carry any load. Or discount import Oriental rug store is where they plan the holy carpet war. Tribes, the tales are told. Sheikh Sultan's quest for the black gold. Don't want their religion, only want their money. Simultaneously dangerous and sexy. Oriental carpet makes for good decorage, but it's not comfy for Oriental massage. Will Shahrazad give me an exotic dance in Casablanca, Alhambra, or France? Della, della, qua, qua, painted naked harems feast. Ava, ava, place, place, south of Europe, yet labeled east. Arabian, Persian, Indian, Chinese, Thai, all close enough for a carpet to fly. Goes from Morocco to Japan, but the West goes from Austria to Washington. Any anything exotic is labeled the Orient. And most of the world lives in that nomad's tent, and no one would trade their trees for sand. The West is happy to just broker the land, often fascinated and intermittently loyal, while filling their lamp with Arabian oil. Oriental, Oriental, magic carpet, magic carpet.
I wish I lived 5% like they lived. The Orient is watched since its almost but never quite offensive behavior issues out of a reservoir of infinite peculiarity. The European, whose sensibility tours the Orient, is a watcher, never involved, always detached, always ready for a new example of what the description d'Egypte called the bizarre jouissance, which could be a strange occurrence. The Orient becomes a living tableau of queerness. And this is Edward Said, who is one of the very most famous philosophers and scholars of the United States, and he's from Palestine originally, and this is the book Orientalism from 1978, which talks about the Westerner's view of what we are. So this is, again, another stereotype. What is a stereotype? Well, it's a stereo. It has two speakers, one for either ear, that tells you two things at the same time, desire and fear, all right? So this is a perfect example of people being unfamiliar with us. I mean, I've ridden a camel once, it really hurt, and I've never done it again. So this is not the typical way that we live whatsoever. Well, you know, my goal is not to argue and preach with people. My goal is to make people more familiar, to give you something that's tangible, something that you could hold on to. Now, speaking of holding on, you see the school program that I showed you the video of earlier, and it is children doing this line dance, and this line dance is called debki. Now, the debki dance is a great way to get people familiar with each other, because you have to hold hands, and you start to sweat, and then they really feel your presence. And what happens? Everybody is stepping and stomping at the same time. So this is a style of dance that comes from Lebanon, Palestine, Syria, Jordan, Iraq, again, all the fashionable countries. And this style of dance, people hold hands and they step at the same time, depending on the music, and they stomp at the same time. The word debki actually means to strike the ground, to stomp. And so what I did, with the help of all the people that have enjoyed this dance with me when I've traveled the world, I've made a lot of friends and students, and they have started troops, debki troops, that have spread the word of debki all over the world and helping other people learn about this special kind of folklore dance that really anybody can do, girl, boy, big, small, slow, fast, all the above. Anybody can really do this type of folk dance. So this is a video, and these are three groups. None of them are Arabs, okay? None of them are Muslims, and they are all doing this dance from around the world, the debki dance. We have a group from Sardinia, which is the island off of Italy. We have a group from Zipiquira, Colombia, which is just down the mountain from Bogota, and then a group from Los Angeles, which is next to the LAX airport.
Sound of the doubly, singing or shouting, a melody.
shoes or boots, but never flip-flops. Making rhymes as if Near Eastern hip-hop. They talk about life in the village or the city. Light feet stepping, all but the stomp is hefty. Look at the girls and they are dancing in the high heels. They are tough yet sexy, it's the real deal. Look at the guys and each one dancing like a man. Swinging the kufiya and low to the ground. Right palm faces up and the left down. Hold each other's hands and walk around. Making a big circle or a long line. All will stomp together at the right time. This is the dance for everyone called Debki. We stomp so hard, we're in hysterics. This is a lesson one of our lyrics. Hello, ha, hello, ha, yeah. Hello, ha, hello, ha, yeah. Yazari fitul, wayna ramallah. Everyone called Debki. Near East Arabs, well this is what we do. Come and do a Debki with us, we want to teach you. Dancing for a wedding or a halfly, or not to back down solidarity. We do a Debki at a raging party. And we do a Debki to obstruct the army. We bring down the house with our stomping sound. But your bulldozer won't knock our house down. Dance for Ramallah and Jebel Lubnan. Dance for Aleppo, Baghdad, and Amman. This is the dance that'll help us have elation. Oh, this is the dance that'll help us save our nation. This is the dance for everyone called Debki. Stomping to the sound of the Dabli. Singing or shouting a melody. Holding a hand because we are family. This is the dance for everyone called Debki. Stomping to the sound of the Dabli. Singing or shouting a melody. Holding a hand because we are family. This is the dance for everyone called Debki.
Mucho gusto. This is a dance that comes from Palestine, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Iraq. I mean, we have so many bad impressions of these places in the United States. They're kicking out all of their, you know, half of their population. I mean, 50% of Syria is, of Syrians right now are refugees, whether they're in refugees within their own country or refugees, as we've seen, trying to get to Europe or Austria and Germany specifically. And so whenever you see or hear some people from this part of the world, obviously we feel bad for them, but let's also understand the great things that they have done. This is a cultural thing, and it's a cultural thing that can be shared not just within themselves, but all around the world too. So next time you see or hear about a Syrian, remember that they hold hands and stomp also. They're not only refugees. Now we have so many foreigners leaving, or we have, let's say, excuse me, we have so many people leaving the Arab world to go and live somewhere else. Not all of them hate their country. Actually, the vast majority would prefer not to leave, but perhaps they would come to Europe or to America to find some kind of different life, or to escape violence, or to find an opportunity. So we've had Arabs in the United States for a very long time. The most famous one is Khalil Gibran. Who has heard of Khalil Gibran? Pronounced Khalil Gibran. Who's heard? He's written The Prophet, which is a book, it's really the number one self-help, the number one selling self-help book in the history of self-help books. The Prophet tells you about, you know, how to treat your wife, how to treat your children, what to do with your money, everything. It's and it's very poetic and cute. He's a great, great author. So there are Arab Americans who've contributed to the American world. But in truth, we have quite a lot of people who are still in transit. So, first-time asylum applications in the European Union, 2015, 1,200,000 plus. The population of Louisville, Kentucky, did I say it right? Louisville is what I was calling it before I got here. Louisville. Thank you. Thank you. I worked on it. I'm going to end up being the refugee away from Louisville now that I said 760,000 plus. Okay? So the amount of people that have escaped into Europe and are looking for asylum far exceeds the population of Louisville. And not everybody succeeds wherever they get to where they're going. As a matter of fact, it's quite difficult to do well in the United States. For example, a lot of people, just like we have the stereotype of the Arabs, Arabs might have stereotype of the United States too. Streets paved with gold, when it's actually streets paved with snow. Lots of competition. It's very, very difficult to adjust sometimes. Some people succeed and some people don't. So this is a story of a man who had a horn that dropped his horn every day. This is a story about a man who left the United States to go back to Egypt. He's originally Egyptian, all right? And then he tried about 2 years of immigration here in the United States. This is a fictitious guy anyway. Tried 2 years here in the United States and then went back to Egypt because it just was a more reasonable life and he was more ready for it. And when he went back to Egypt, he decided to become an entrepreneur, which is what he learned in the United States. An entrepreneur, which means he bought a tuk-tuk. Now, tuk-tuk is a three-wheeled taxi, a rickshaw. And these are all over the Arab world. Now, they originally were only in Thailand and India, but now they're all over the Arab world because it's so densely populated, it's a great way to get around. So this is a story of a man who went back to Egypt after he figured out what he's doing. There we go. Baladi tuk-tuk. Oh, wait.
Was an immigrant in America, serving canned hummus, it's a joke. And so he left Aladdin's back to Cairo. Now he drives his own tuk-tuk. He worked 18 hours, just broke even. Spare cash, bought hookah, smoke. Now he's back in the homeland, self-employed, with a pimped out Baladi tuk-tuk. Oh well, he begged to have a visa and get out of Giza. Tired of all the poverty, all of the favoritism lottery. Years of education, loving Egyptian nation. Well, he wanted to do better, wanted to wear leather pants and act the way he wants. Doesn't know what he wants, well he only sees it on the internet. Satellite and spotlight, all the glitzy lifestyle. Never find that near the night. Dating girls easy, don't have to meet their family. Ride the cheapest one-way plane to Disney. Here I am in the USA. Iowa waiting for his money payday. And still waiting, awaiting, 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 wait. He was an immigrant in America, serving canned hummus, it's a joke. And so he left Aladdin's back to Cairo. Now he drives his own tuk-tuk. He worked 18 hours, just broke even. Spare cash, bought hookah, smoke. Now he's back in the homeland, self-employed, with a pimped out Baladi tuk-tuk. Well, his diploma was worthless, it had no equivalence. Years of engineering here is only good for steering trucks or lifting boxes. Not chic enough for the Louisville Foxes. Working in the kitchen, washing dishes and complaining. Living in the neighborhood that smells the least good. A broken English ghetto slum alone with everyone. Wearing heavy winter coat, chosen to be frozen joke, and slightly worse than Cairo B because he has no family. And isn't it funny how the act of chasing money can leave a person so damn lonely. He was an immigrant in America, serving camp hummus, it's a joke. So he left Aladdin's back to Cairo. Now he drives his own truck. He worked 18 hours, just broke even. Spare cash, bought hookah, smoke. Now he's back in the homeland, self-employed, with a pimped out Baladi tuk-tuk.
Well, moving back to Cairo. He only left 2 years ago. Money in his galabeya, not enough to make him stay yet. He missed his own people, wanted to see both minarets and steeples. But all his experience had meaning. He learned about dealing. All that he endured made him an entrepreneur. And so he bought a motor rickshaw. It can't go fast nor far. Egyptian call it tuk-tuk, blasting all the smoke, taking people down the street in case they hate to use their feet. But he wants no more long trips on airplanes or ships. He just wants to personalize his tuk-tuk that flies down the Hara and the Zuqaq, blasting Shabi, Baladi rocks. Baladi, 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 بلدي وبلا لح لحنا وبلدي وبلا لح لا 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 بلدي بلدي توك 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 Was I immigrant in America, serving canned hummus, it's a joke. So he left Aladdin's back to Cairo. Now he drives his own tuk tuk. He worked 18 hours, just broke even. Spare cash, bought hookah, smoke. And now he's back in the homeland, self-employed with a pimped out Baladi tuk tuk. Oh, with a pimped out Baladi tuk tuk. Oh, with a pimped out Baladi tuk tuk. Oh, with a pimped out Baladi tuk tuk. Thank you, everybody. So this is one sad story, but there are many good ones. The whole idea is we're aware of everybody. The people who want to come here, the people who are forced to come here, and then the people who really integrated. So to know about the whole Arab culture and the Muslim culture, well, the first thing is just get to know the people that are living here among you. So I, for example, I love it in the United States. And I've done pretty well because I've really adapted. I've learned the language. I eat that food, the hot dog, the hamburger, and I enjoy it. I watch the football that they use with the hands. You know, I voted, you know, like I voted in like seven elections now, you know, and I feel like I belong. But I also feel like I belong because it's allowed me to belong. Because, well, I think of it like the national anthem, for example. So we have, you know, oh, say, can you see? Now, when you go to a football game, when you go to any kind of sporting event, there are people singing this anthem. But everybody gives it a little bit of their own feeling, right? So you have people that, you know, do the R&B style. You know, you have the people who do the rock and roll style or whatever. But it still applies to everybody. So this is why I felt like I could stay. This is why I felt like I could participate and that I would enjoy it here. And the most important thing is that I found a purpose here, too, which is to be able to connect the two worlds within my own life. So that maybe if a child, next time there's some bad terrorist event, that the child will have friends in the school and not enemies. That the child will not automatically be criticized or whatever, because now there's more people here that understand what it means to be of a multicultural and to be able to share cultures together. So this is the very, very last thing that I'm going to perform for you today, and you've been a really, really excellent audience. Thank you so much for inviting me to this convocation. The Arab American National Anthem.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you very much. Very much enjoyed teaching you today. Very much enjoyed sharing our cultures together. And I hope to see you all again. Thank you very, very much. Thank you very, very much. We really appreciate it. Thank you. Shukran, shukran, shukran.